So in the last session of our lecture on American assets, we started discussing the valuation of Bermudan options. And well, most important aspect in this part was that we understood that we have to find some method to approximate the conditional expectation operator in a Monte Carlo simulation. And so the remainder of this session is of more general interest, that you can also apply it in other applications, not necessarily mathematical finance. But the valuation of Bermudan options was our motivation. And well, to go back here a little bit, to the backward algorithm. This was the algorithm that actually allowed us to construct a random variable u of t, where t is actually the optimal exercise time on every pass. So t is a stochastic time, and u is the value you receive at that time on that pass, such that u tilde of t, tilde was the relative price, is then the random variable. If you take the expectation of that random variable, you get the value of the Bermudan. And the construction was quite easy. You start with the last point in your time discretization, that is, after you have passed the last exercise state, you receive nothing. And then you have some exercise criteria. So you exercise whenever your underlying value is larger than the expectation. And in that case, so which is here the second case, you take the underlying. Otherwise, you take the value that you would get in the future if you continue. Yeah. So that was this value here, which you get in the future if you continue. And I've drawn a little picture that actually showed that it is important here to choose the value which you get if you continue. So actually the value in the future instead of the expectation of the future values. From a mathematical point of view, it is okay to have here this expectation operator and such that this choice here becomes just a maximum function, which it is, just maximize your value. But from a numerical aspect, it's important actually to have here the value that you see in the future and not the expectation of the future values. And the reason is that this guy here will be approximated, and approximation means we make an error. And so having it at only a very few places is good, and we have it only in the decision and not in the valuation. Yeah. So we have it only in this decision. Okay, so that was the motivation, that we need to find method to approximate a conditional expectation. We already reviewed two possibilities. First one was brute force resimulation. So that's the idea of brute force resimulation. You simulate a Monte Carlo path, and if you are here and you like to find a conditional expectation condition that you arrived here, you create another Monte Carlo simulation and take the expectation. And this suffers from the curse of dimension. Yeah? So here it is the curse of discretization, time discretization points. So for every time discretization point, this grows exponentially in the number of time discretization points. Another extreme we can take was that of doing perfect foresight. So perfect foresight was that I approximate the conditional expectation of a random variable by just taking the value of this random variable on the corresponding path. And that was where we finished our last session. So let me give you a very short example of what happens in perfect foresight. I consider here the setup that we have a simulation which only consists of two Monte Carlo paths. Yeah. So the filtration at point T1 is this trivial filtration because the two Monte Carlo paths agree before T1, and then they differ. Yeah. So it's this picture here, the path omega 1 and omega 2 is the same up to time T1, and then the paths go different routes. So you see the information you have in T1 is just this filtration that anything can happen or nothing can happen, yeah, empty set or full set omega. So this means that a random variable that is FT1 measurable has the same value on both passes. Yeah? It cannot have different values on the two passes. A random variable which is not FT1 measurable but FT2 measurable, yeah, can have a different value here and a different value there. So now I assume that the payments we receive in this option are 4 if we are on the path omega 1. So in our notation, we would say the value of underlying 2 on path omega is 4 if we are on path omega 1, and otherwise it is 1 if we are on path omega 2. Okay, so the conditional expectation, yeah, so this here, maybe I write it a little bit more precise, is the value of underlying 2 at time t2. The conditional expectation of this, so at an earlier point in time, so now conditional expectation is an FT1 measurable random variable, so it has to be the same for all omegas. Yeah? So this conditional expectation is, okay, I have here assumed that probabilities are 1/2, 1/2, so it is 2.5. So since you know that you receive 2 if you exercise here, and you receive 2.5 in expectation if you don't exercise there, the admissible optimal exercise strategy would be to exercise in T2. Yeah? So optimal strategy. Do not exercise in T1. So which means your stochastic time T of omega is on every path T2. So now assume that we go with perfect foresight. And perfect foresight means that I have a Monte Carlo simulation. So we have already drawn this picture here. So you have a Monte Carlo simulation, which looks like this. And instead of doing a resimulation, you just take the path that was already part of your simulation. So you don't do the resimulation, you just take the red line. So if you take perfect foresight, it means that I approximate here the conditional expectation So we approximate the conditional expectation of the value of the underlying 2, T2, conditional to T1. We approximate it by just taking the value that we get in this future point on this path. So value underlying 2, T2 of omega. Yeah? So conditional expectation operator is a random variable itself. So there is some omega. So maybe I add this here. Okay. So that is here of omega. Yeah? So we have some pass omega, and you take just the value which you will receive. So with foresight, yeah, our exercise strategy would be if we are on path omega 1, we take 4, because we know that we take that we will receive 4. 4 is larger than 2. If we are on path omega 2, we approximate the conditional expectation with 1, yeah, because we see the future. 2 is larger than 1. It's optimal to exercise in T1. So which means the value which we get is the value of the Bermudan. We get 4 on path omega 1 and 2 on path omega 2. So we exercise on omega 1, we exercise in T2, get 4. On omega 2, we exercise in T1 and get 2. So the value of the Bermudan is 3. Okay, so the value of the Bermudan is higher because we know the future and we can maximize something out of this. Okay, so you see, foresight is not a good method to approximate the conditional expectation, or put differently, you could use it, but you have to be aware that this gives you a bias and the value you obtain is too high because you have knowledge of the future, which you otherwise wouldn't have. Okay. Beginning of this lecture, I mentioned that sometimes the computer helps you to understand a method or a problem. And before we continue, I would like to do a small plot with the computer. You know that in the last session, I have drawn something with hand, yeah, a picture where you see the exercise values and the continuation values, and I would like to create this plot just very, very quickly with the computer, because then maybe you understand even better what you see in this picture. So I have prepared a little bit here. Okay, so yeah, usually I like doing live coding, but to save a little bit of time, and since you have seen this very often, I have already prepared something. So I like to create a Black-Scholes model. Yeah, so these lines here are just create a Black-Scholes model. So I have some initial value, risk-free rate and volatility. Okay, so maybe I move this here a little bit on the top because this is all about the model. Yeah. So then I I need the time horizon here. Let's hard code it. Okay, so this is our model. So initial value is 100. Maybe one small remark, the risk-free rate you see here is 0. So I don't need to divide by the numerator. The numerator is e to the 0 times t is always 1. Yeah, so that saves me a little bit of space below. Volatility is 30%, time horizon is 2, time discretization is 1, so I have 2 time steps. And in this model, I like to look at a Bermudan option with 2 exercise states. So that was the example which we already discussed. So maturity 1, so T1 is 1, maturity 2 is 2, yeah, so that is T2, and I have 2 different strikes. Okay, so and now I have a model, a Black-Scholes model, and from that model, I would like to have S at T2. Okay, so that's the value of the stock in T2, and I would like to have S in T1. Then we have a Bermudan option, yeah, so that is an option on an option. So if we continue, yeah, then in T2 we have the payoff maximum of S of T2 minus K and 0. So this is what I calculate here, S minus K, maximum of this and 0. And I also calculate the same for T T1, because that would be the option if I just have the exercise date T1. Okay, so you know that the conditional expectation of this guy here, so the option which you have in T2, so if you continue, the conditional expectation of this guy is actually what you need to decide whether you exercise here or whether you continue. And in the Plek-Schultz model, I know the conditional expectation of this future option. What is it? It is just given by Plek-Schultz formula. But in Plek-Schultz formula, so here there's Plek-Schultz formula, there are two small aspects which you have to be aware of now. So this is the value of the option two, yeah, seen in T1. So this means that what you have here in the Plek-Schultz formula for the maturity is the remaining time. It's just T2 minus T1. So we already arrived in T1, okay, and then we can go to T2. So the maturity here is the remaining maturity. And then the Plek-Schultz formula, so if you move here to the formula, you see the arguments are initial stock value, risk-free rate, volatility. So the initial stock value is a random variable, okay? It is S of T1. So this is what it makes a conditional expectation. So conditional that we started here, this is the value of the option. So the result here is a random variable too. So this Plek-Schultz formula here is just say some operator which maps pathwise, path by path. So now we know that this is the conditional expectation. So this is a lucky case where we have an analytic formula. Yeah. Okay. So let's maybe first forget about these two is here, and I just plot now these values. Yeah, so I plot the continuation value. The continuation value is the value of the option if I continue. So it's this one here. If I continue, I plot the exercise value, which is the value which I get in T1 if I exercise, and I plot the Plek-Schultz formula. Okay, so a very simple plot. Okay, so let's maybe just run this and create the plot. Okay, so we see this little plot here. So let's again annotate this. Yeah? What we already discussed was that if you have now some poor approximation of the conditional expectation, yeah, for example, this here is your poor approximation of the conditional expectation, the optimal decision point would have been here, but now with this poor approximation, it is here, and the only error you make is that you have a wrong decision. Yeah? So the optimal choice for your payoff would be choose the green line when you are above the blue line, choose the blue line, choose the conditional expectation when the blue line is above the green one. And now the only thing is that you make the wrong decision. So the wrong decision would be now that you go here and then you go here. Okay, which is a comparably small error, yeah? So only this triangle. And these red values here are the values, well, on the x-axis is S of T1. So these are the points S of T1 and omega is my x-axis. And what do I get if I continue? So V of T2 and omega, no? So which is maximum of S of T2 minus K and zero. Okay, and the trick in the backward algorithm is that we take the expectation not of either green line or blue line, so either green dots or blue dots, depending on our exercise. We take it on red dots if we don't exercise, or green dots if we exercise. So take the values instead of the conditional expectation. Now I like to show you what are the values which we actually take. Okay, so let's go back to our program. And the values which we are actually taking are the following. What is our exercise decision? So this is this line here. Maybe that line here is not needed yet. So these are the values which we actually take. So our exercise decision is the value of the option calculated from the Plek-Schultz formula. So the value of the option 2 seen in T1 larger than that what we get if we exercise. So we take the difference of the two, and then we choose, depending on if this difference is positive or negative, to continue. And you see here, I choose the red dot. Yeah, these are the red dots. I choose the continuation value, or I choose to exercise. Yeah, so you see, this is here our choice. Yeah, either that one or that one. But the choice is based on the conditional expectation of this argument. Okay, so let's also plot this. So I can add this here in the plot and plot now what we get if we add these points. And these points are now dark green. So we get this picture. Okay, and you see we get the dark green points. So this here is the point where we perform optimal exercise. So on the right-hand side of this, we take the green points. So we exercise. So you see all these guys here are dark green. Yeah? But on the left of this point, you see that here the line has no dark green points, and all the red points have become dark green. And the value of the Bermudan is now the expectation of the dark green points. Yeah? On the left-hand side, continue and take what you get in the future. On the right-hand side, exercise and take the green line, yeah? Which is also just a point made out of points. Okay. So the value of the Bermudan is now the unconditional expectation. Yeah? So that's an important part. Yeah? So now that I have this set up here, we can take the unconditional expectation of the dark green points. And the line, okay? So, and now to conclude, what actually is perfect foresight in our computer program? So in our computer program, perfect foresight is that you base the decision not on the conditional expectation, but on the value itself. Yeah? So actually it is take the maximum of what you get in the future and what you get if you exercise. So actually this line here, I can also rewrite it. Yeah. So I can rewrite it such that it looks a little bit similar to the previous line. I take the difference of the value which I get in T2 if I continue. Yeah? So the T2 here is important. Yeah, there's a T1 here, but a T2 there. I take the difference of the value which I get if I continue and the value which I get if I exercise. And based on this trigger, yeah, I either choose the value if I continue or the value if I exercise. So you see what we get here is the same, but the decision is a different one. And you also see that here in the decision, it's always a T1. So the decision is based on an FT1 measurable random variable. So the decision can be made in T1. But here, the decision has a random variable which has a T2. Yeah? So you see there is a T2 here in the name. Okay. And this means that here there is a T2 in the stock. So here there is a 2. Yeah? So this guy here is an is not FT1 measurable. And now let's plot this Dermutant value. Okay, so I plot also these. So I switch here to the other function. Yeah, so on the x-axis we have the stock, on the y-axis now we have this Dermutant value with foresight. Okay, and let's see what happens in the picture if we take this. Okay, so now I get this picture. Okay, and you see that what happens if you are able to look into the future and you take always the point which maximizes the value. Yeah. So while previously on our exercise decision point, so our exercise decision point was here. Yeah? So it was to the left, we continue. To the right, we take the green line, we exercise. So now on the right-hand side, you see that I take only those values where I already know that that they will be above the green line. Yeah? So you see that there is a bias here. And instead of taking the green line, we have many points here and no points here. So you see the unconditional expectation of the dark green dots are much higher on the right-hand side than the green line. Yeah? So that's your bias, that you have a bias high. Okay, so that was foresight. So now with this little picture here, yeah, so this is the correct exercise value. Yeah, this was here our picture. There is one little observation. When I made this plot, yeah, so then this line here is actually the conditional expectation of the option we see, of the option two, yeah, seen in T1. Yeah, so that line was the Black-Scholes formula, and okay. And in our code, if you go back to the code, yeah, this here was our conditional expectation. And you see that the conditional expectation is actually a random variable. But why is it a random variable? It is just a Black-Scholes formula. So why is it a random variable? Because this argument here is random. So you see that this is actually a function of the stock, of the initial value. So if you go back to the picture, then this condition here is actually fully described by the value of the stock in T1. Yeah? So this is a special case here in this example. It wouldn't be that the case for example, for an Asian option, yeah? A Bermudan option on an Asian underlying, because then more information from the past could be relevant. But here, the only information that is relevant to get the conditional expectation is the value of the stock at time T1. So you actually see that this here is just some function of T1. Yeah. And this function of T1, yeah, so maybe we have it here. This value here is the conditional expectation of all the dots we find here. So maybe it doesn't look like this in this picture because there are so many dots which are here far out. Yeah, for example, there's that one here, which are far out. But actually, remember that this here is a log normal distribution. Yeah, so the distribution here looks like this. Okay, and then we get this conditional expectation. Or maybe like this. Okay. Well, maybe this is a nice interpretation, and this moves now to the next point. We can interpret the conditional expectation as a functional dependence on some random variable. Okay, and this will lead us a step further to methods now to estimate the conditional expectation more accurately than we did before. Okay, so if you think again here of this picture, yeah, we just discussed in the script, it was figure 24, yeah, then you see that you can interpret the conditional expectation as depending on some realization of a random variable. In our example here, it was the value of the stock when we arrived, yeah, at the condition time. And this means that we can ask ourselves, do we know a random variable z such that z is an FT1 measurable random variable and the conditional expectation FT1 is actually just the conditional expectation conditional to z. So what's here actually just means that the random variable z generates the sigma algebra FT1. So sigma of z is FT1. Okay, is this possible that we find such a random variable? Well, actually, if you think of your numerical methods, for example, your Euler scheme, then this is very easy. Yeah? I can immediately name such a random variable. Okay, so consider, for example, Euler scheme. So Euler scheme for your Monte Carlo simulation tells you the next value of your model quantities is the previous value of your model quantities plus some mu delta t plus some sigma delta w, okay, w of ti. And this looks like this. So you start at some initial value, say here, and then we draw a random number. So we generate the next realization, and we draw a random number, generate the next realization, and draw a random number. Okay. And the same for a different path here, like that. You draw a random number, you draw a random number, and you generate these guys. Okay, when do you have full information about the path? When are you able to reconstruct the full path? Okay, just if you know all the random numbers, you can reconstruct the path. Okay, so complete knowledge of the filtration up to time t1 is given by knowing the random variable z, which is just the vector of all Brownian increments up to time tk, where tk plus 1 is then t1. Yeah? So just all the steps you have in your Brownian motion. If you know all the random variables, you know the path. Okay, so actually we can, in our discrete setup, yeah, so that's also nice here, yeah, in the computer, many things are far more simple. Yeah, there is a random vector here that fully describes the filtration. Okay, of course, sometimes this vector is too large, yeah, but it's maybe now good for the intuition that in theory such a thing would exist. So here this d, yeah, the dimension d you see here would be the number of time steps up to time t1 in your Euler discretization. So now I have an alternative representation of my conditional expectation operator. I can consider it as a function. Yeah. So conditional expectation with respect conditional to z just means that conditional that the vector z has a certain value. Yeah? So now I'm not interested in the omegas, I'm interested in the values of this random variable z. But I can identify a path omega just by the values z, at least up to time t1, that were used up to time t1. So now I have an alternative representation of the conditional expectation as a functional dependence. Here in the script, this is just the graph again, which we plotted. And here the functional dependence, the z, is actually now here on the x-axis. And in our case, it was the s of t1. So in the previous setup, there was such a z, which was just the s of t1. So this z is, as I already mentioned, the random variable such that ft1, such that this is ft1 measurable, and ft1 is the smallest such sigma field with respect to which z is measurable. So actually you can also think that this ft1 is the inverse of your Borel sigma algebra. Okay, so now endowed with this interpretation, if we go back to actually our picture here, maybe we have an idea to get a numerical approximation for the conditional expectation. So the conditional expectation is now a function of my random variable z. Yeah? So this here is my random variable z equals z1, okay? And instead of saying conditional to some filtration or some set in the filtration, I now say conditional to that the random variable z has the value z1. Yeah? In this case here, z1 is approximately 177. Yeah? Okay, so conditional expectation then means you take all the values that fulfill the condition, and from these values you take the expectation, which means you go along this line, and all the red dots that lie on this line, from all the red dots that lie on this line, I take the expectation, and this is then the conditional expectation, this point. Actually, if you look in this picture and you draw another line here, yeah, so maybe I draw another line here, you see, unfortunately, there's only a single red dot lying on this line. Yeah? It's only this red dot which lies on this line. So doing this with the conditional expectation is like perfect foresight. Yeah? Because in my Monte Carlo simulation, it's actually rather a null event, yeah, that I hit this line. Okay, but maybe I can just draw the line a little bit thicker. And now I say conditional to z being 90, I take the expectation of all the red dots in this corridor. And there are a few dots in this corridor. Yeah? And maybe then the approximation of your conditional expectation is this one, which is maybe a good approximation. Yeah, it's a little bit off from the analytic one, but maybe this is a decent approximation. So now by having this interpretation, maybe we have found a nice method to approximate the conditional expectation operator. So the issue is that if you have here a condition variable and you take, for example, the set where this has a certain value, yeah, then this would correspond to a perfect foresight. But what we could do is we approximate the conditional expectation conditional to Z, conditional expectation is a random variable. So on a path omega, by taking all the values of Z that lie in an epsilon neighborhood of this Z of omega. So if we go back now to our little picture, this means that if you have a Monte Carlo path, for example, that one, this red dot here, you calculate for this Monte Carlo path the Z, which is 90. Yeah, so S of T1 on this path omega is 90. Then you take some epsilon neighborhood around this 90 and define your approximation for the conditional expectation as take the expectation over all passes where Z, so in our case S of T1 and omega, lies in this neighborhood. So Z here of an omega is replaced by all the Z which lie in an epsilon neighborhood of Z of omega. This is a very nice method. Yeah, just define some epsilon and you have now a very fast approximation method for your conditional expectation. Note also that we only do this with the passes that we have already simulated. Yeah. So in the picture, this looks like this. Yeah. This here is the time T1. And then such an interval here is an epsilon neighborhood around S of T1 and say omega k, if, for example, this here is the path omega k that passes this. Okay, so maybe there's some paths here which I call omega k. Yeah, so this is my path omega k. Then I check what is the value of this path of S of T1 on this path. Yeah. Around this value, I choose the epsilon neighborhood. And then I take the conditional expectation of all the passes that pass through this bin, yeah, through this interval. And you see that this is maybe a little bit like resimulation. If the bin is very small, it becomes more like resimulation. But since we only take the passes which we have, if the bin becomes too small, it actually becomes perfect foresight. Because if the bin is too small, the only path that passes through this bin is S of T1 and omega k. Yeah? And we take the, just the average over this single path. Yeah? Okay, so that's a binning, yeah, very nice method. Maybe let's illustrate how this method would look in our example of a Bermudan option, which has two exercise dates, two strikes, and is in the Plick-Scholes model. Yeah? What we like to have is the conditional expectation of the value if we continue, yeah, divided by the numerator, yeah, all relative prices, conditional to FT1. Yeah. So this means now I can replace here the conditional sigma field FT1, so the condition time, I can replace it by what is the value that the stock has in T1. So there's already something inside here. In order to make this replacement, I have to know that the variable S of T1 is sufficient to describe the conditioning that this value, this variable, has all the information I need. Actually, you could also replace it with maybe a random variable which does not have all information but enough information. In that case, the step from the first expectation to the second expectation would already be an approximation. Yeah, we will do this later. Okay, so this means that we interpret this value here, the continuation value, as a function of S of T1. So these are actually the red dots in the previous figure. Yeah. So that was the intuition which we got from this figure. And then we replace the conditional to S of T1 by conditional to that S of T1 is in an epsilon neighborhood of a given value. Yeah? And we see this as an approximation for S of T1 has a specific value. Okay, so that is the binning. And if you now do this, you will maybe arrive at this picture. Yeah. So I have to calculate a conditional expectation of the red dots. Yeah, the red dots are the value if I continue. So what we do is we take some epsilon neighborhood here. And from this epsilon neighborhood, I take the expectation, and this expectation is then this value here. When I moved now to this picture, I made a small change in the method. So instead of using for every pass a fixed epsilon neighborhood, which means that for every pass I have a new epsilon neighborhood, which means if I simulate 10,000 passes, I have 10,000 different epsilon neighborhoods. Actually, to make the algorithm a little bit faster, I just used a fixed discretization of the value S into a fixed set of disjoint neighborhoods. Then I arrive at this picture. If I do this additional step, you see that your conditional expectation, yeah, so here is another conditional expectation approximated. Your conditional expectation becomes a piecewise constant function of your predictor variable. Yeah? S of T1 is your predictor variable, a piecewise constant function of this predictor variable. And you see sometimes, for example, here in this region where your Monte Carlo simulation on the outside, it has very few passes. Yeah? Sometimes you get poor approximations because you have too few passes, yeah, and this is just the Monte Carlo error. Yeah? So this is just the Monte Carlo error, and here I have fewer Monte Carlo passes, so I have a larger Monte Carlo error. Okay. This is an interesting interpretation now. So what we do is we approximate the true conditional expectation, which in this graph here is this red line, by a piecewise constant function. And the piecewise constant function is defined such that every value here on these intervals is the expectation on this bin. So now you see some cloud here, yeah? This is a cloud of points, and you like to find a function that passes through this cloud and approximates the conditional expectation of this cloud. So maybe instead of a piecewise constant function, maybe we could use something more smooth, yeah? For example, like a polynomial or so. How can we achieve this? So the next step is that the conditional expectation operator actually has an alternative definition. And this then leads us to reinterpreting this binning as a least square regression. So least square means minimize the L2 distance. Okay. And this is the alternative interpretation of the expectation operator. So just to explain this slide here. So what I did on the previous picture was that I have a fixed set of bins, a discretization. So this here is a disjoint discretization. Of the set of values of Z, yeah. And then we take here the conditional expectation as a piecewise constant function, where each such constants here, so this HI, yeah, so this value here is such an HI, is just the expectation over all values for which Z is in the spin. Yeah? So actually you can also write this as the expectation of the guy of which you like to take the expectation. In our case, it is always this continuation value. Yeah? So this is here over all passes omega, which are in this Z. Yeah. So which omegas, for which omega is Z mapped to inside the set of UI? Okay. And so the next step now in my slow movement to a better approximation for the conditional expectation is that there is an alternative interpretation of the conditional expectation, and that is the conditional expectation or the expectation operator is the random variable which minimizes the L2 distance to the argument of the operator among all FT1 measurable random variables. Okay, so let's formulate this. So we have here a little lemma. So the expectation of a random variable X is the number H for which X minus H has the smallest L2 norm. So the expectation of a random variable X is the number H for which X minus H has the smallest L2 norm. Okay, just let's check this. Yeah, so you see, expectation of X minus H squared is expectation of X minus 2 times expectation of X times H plus H squared. So if this is now a function of H and you like to minimize, yeah, then df by dh is minus 2 expectation of x plus 2h. So if I like to find the minimum, this means that h is expectation of X. So if we go back here to our picture here, it means that this horizontal line here, so this one, is actually the horizontal level where the distance, the L2 distance of the red dots to this horizontal level is minimized. Yeah? Okay, so why is this a better formulation for our problem? Because it means the task to find the conditional expectation now is, among all the piecewise constant functions, find the piecewise constant function that minimizes the L2 distance to the red cloud. So this is a regression. And if you have this formulation, it's now only a minimal step to replace piecewise constant function by something else. So among all functions, find the function of S of t1, yeah, so such that it is still an ft1 measurable random variable, that minimizes the distance to the red dots. So using this lemma, we can actually rewrite the conditional expectation as a minimization problem. So recall here that hi is the value which we were looking for. Yeah. So hi is the conditional expectation conditioned to the bin ui. So we like to calculate the conditional expectation of this random variable conditioned to actually ft1, yeah, but now I'm conditioning to z, my predictor variable, lies in the bin ui. So this is my piecewise constant function, and now this hi here is actually the value g that minimizes this L2 distance. Okay, so finding hi is find g such that expectation of v divided by n minus g squared conditional to this bin is minimized. This is actually for every such bin, for every such interval. But now the intervals are independent. So, and minimizing two independent problems is the same as minimizing the sum. Yeah, it's here positive. Yeah, it's squared. Yeah? So minimizing these L2 distances individually is actually can be rewritten as a single minimization problem. So since all my bins here are disjoint, we can write this as a single minimization problem for a vector. So now here we have a vector hi. So this vector hi are the values of your piecewise constant function such that the sum here over all those distances is minimized. So finding each of these levels individually is actually the same as globally minimizing all the levels over all the bins. Yeah? It's because here these bins here are disjoint. Yeah? These are independent problems. The vector hi together with the uis, that is this set, what is the bin, what is the value, yeah, for all the i's, this describes a piecewise constant function. And here the set with all these g's is the set of all possible piecewise constant function being piecewise constant, yeah, so being constant on ui. Yeah. So this here is the set of all such functions, piecewise constant on ui. So now I do another step. I can reformulate this. Among the piecewise constant functions, which are constant on ui, find that function which minimizes the L2 distance. So now I have reformulated it instead of a value on every bin as a minimization problem over a function space. So I introduce now here some function space. So let H be the space of all functions that are constant on the bins. This means for a function H in this function space script H here, H of omega is a specific constant Hi, given that omega is in the bin UI. So omega in the bin UI means omega in Z inverse of UI, which means Z of omega is in this bin. Yeah? So Z is the variable which tells me where we are. Then the conditional expectation, my conditional expectation is a piecewise constant function approximating the conditional expectation. This is the function that has the minimum L2 distance among all possible such functions. Okay, so now this is just what we did with binning. Actually, with the little bit more stricter form with binning, where we have a fixed discretization of our x-axis of our values in two bins UI. And now it's just formulated a little bit more complicated. Yeah. So binning, calculating the conditional expectation, conditional that we are in a certain bin, is among all the piecewise constant function, find that piecewise constant function which minimizes the L2 distance. Okay, so binning is an L2 regression. While this formulation looks more complicated than the stuff which we had in the beginning, yeah, so just take a certain bin and then just count the values and take the average. Yeah? So this formulation looks much more complicated. There are two advantages here. The first one is that we can actually replace the definition of H with something else. So we can now say among all polynomials, among all other stuff. Yeah? So we can actually do this. The only thing is that these are functions of a random variable z, and z is FT1 measurable. So if this is a function of an FT1 measurable random variable, then this will correspond to the FT1, or actually approximate the FT1 conditional expectation. Yeah. So then this object here will also be FT1 measurable. Yeah? So a function, so this guy here has the T1 inside. Yeah. It is a random variable which predicts values in T1. So that is the first step. We can use some other function space here. And the second step is that if this function space has a certain structure, namely it is a linear combination of basis functions, then this minimization problem here can be solved explicitly with some linear algebra. Okay, so actually you can find this solution here analytically. Okay, and this now is the motivation for actually a very successful numerical method to approximate the conditional expectation in a Monte Carlo simulation. Yeah, so very, very successful, very popular, very powerful. And it is sometimes called least squared Monte Carlo because, yeah, so now you know, because the conditional expectation is a least squared minimizer, or sometimes it's called regression method because we will perform a linear regression. And sometimes it's called also American Monte Carlo because it is needed to value American option or Bermudan option. Okay, so as a motivation, yeah, there is a disadvantage of binning. For example, one disadvantage is I started by this Black-Scholes example, where everything we need, so all the information, is contained in the value of the stock at time t1. But this is maybe not always the case. This is a very simple case. Consider a random variable where the conditional expectation actually depends on the whole path. Yeah, on the whole path. So then your predictor variable z is all the Brownian increments you have on this path from 0 to time t1. So I had this example that the value z can be such a high dimensional thing. So assume that you have 10 time steps. Then what is your bin? Your bin is an epsilon neighborhood of a vector which has 10 dimensions. So it is maybe a 10-dimensional sphere. And then binning becomes very complicated. It also has a curse of dimension. Yeah. So how do you discretize this 10-dimensional space? So maybe we would like to perform some reduction in this predictor variable. And another disadvantage, yeah, which I have here on the slide, is that we have a piecewise constant approximation. And maybe an obvious improvement to this piecewise constant one would be to have a smooth function in the random variable set. Yeah? So instead of having this stairs there, yeah, I would like to have something more smooth. Okay, so this gives rise now to the least square approximation of the conditional expectation. Yeah? And here it is. So we start with some filter probability space, yeah, and we like to find a random variable v. Yeah, so now I use v for the conditional expectation. So this v is an FT1 measurable random variable, and it should be the conditional expectation of some random variable u. Yeah, so this is my v here. So I would like to approximate v. So I need some predictor variables. So my predictor variables is random variable y, yeah, which is maybe a vector of random variables y1 to yp. Yeah. So this guy here, maybe I draw it in green, this guy here corresponds to the z. But it may be smaller, yeah. So maybe you know that you actually need all the Brownian increments, but maybe it's just sufficient to have a few. Yeah. So this predictor variable, which we have here in the theorem, could be smaller. Yeah? If you make it smaller, we approximate the conditional expectation on a smaller space. The approximation will be maybe not so good. So therefore, I choose a different letter. So now it's y. So y is a set of FT1 measurable random variables. So it's a vector of FT1 measurable random variables. So this means if I write my conditional expectation as a function of y, it is guaranteed that this is an FT1 measurable random variable. So this is also what prevents perfect foresight. You are not allowed to use a random variable z or y that is FT2 measurable but not FT1 measurable. Yeah? So you are not allowed to use information from the future. You are only allowed to make this functional dependence on objects which you know in T1. So then, speaking of a functional dependence, I would like to have some function. Yeah. So now I have a function here, f. And I consider here a parametric function. The first argument of this function is the y. So that's why we have here a p. Yeah? So I have a p vector here. But then the function allows for some parameter. And this parameter here is a q vector. So my conditional expectation is now searched for in the set of all random variables f of y and alpha. So y is fixed, given, yeah? And alpha is now a parameter which we vary. So actually, we would like to find the best parameter alpha inside this function that has the smallest L2 distance so such that f of y and alpha has the smallest L2 distance to our random variable u. Yeah, so u is the one of which we like to calculate the conditional expectation. Yeah? So here, this is the u. So you see, I like to calculate the conditional expectation of u. And I know that conditional expectation is the object which minimizes the L2 distance. So I now search for my approximation to the conditional expectation in the set of all possible random variables f of y and alpha, minimizing over all alpha. So it could be that the true conditional expectation is not inside this set. Yeah? That's why this is only an approximation. But if the set is rich enough, so if the vector y contains enough information, and if the parametrization by alpha allows me to construct out of this y all possible random variables, yeah, then this actually is the conditional expectation. So my conditional expectation is now the alpha star that minimizes this L2 distance. So this is now my conditional expectation, my candidate for the conditional expectation. So I define my least square approximation of the conditional expectation as the function f of alpha star, where alpha star is the parameter such that among all random variables f of y and alpha, the L2 distance is minimized. Okay, so I'm looking here for this approximation in a restricted set, but as I will also have later on the slide, our binning is just a special case. Yeah? So, for example, in the binning, these random variables here, y, are just the indicator functions of the bin. Yeah? Indicator function of u1, indicator function of u2, and so on. And you know that a piecewise constant function is just this, the sum alpha I indicator function ui. Yeah? So our piecewise constant, our set of piecewise constant functions is just the sum of alpha I indicator function ui. So binning is just a special case of this setup, and a very simple case. Yeah, p equals q, q. Okay, so we have this later. So that's now my more general reformulation, and you see now we have a lot of degrees of freedom. So we are free to choose here the predictor variables, and we are free to choose here the function which parametrizes our function space. There is a special choice which makes life much easier, and that choice is that you look only among the linear combinations of the random variables y. Okay, so that means p is equal to q, and our function is just the sum alpha I yi. Binning would be of this case, yeah, for the special case yi is just the indicator function. If you are in this special situation that the function f is just a linear function of the y's, then this has a big advantage because then we can calculate the optimal alpha star. So the parameter which minimizes the L2 distance, we can calculate it analytically. Okay, and how can this be calculated? So here is the solution. It's just a small linear algebra matrix inversion thing. So the setup is as follows. So our function is of this special form, alpha I y I, and we like to find the alpha star such that the L2 distance v minus f of y and alpha is minimized. Yeah, so alpha star is minimizing this L2 distance. Okay, can we shortly prove this result? Yeah. So actually, what is the result? So the result is that this alpha star is just given by x transposed x inverse multiplied with x transposed v. What is x and what is v? So x is the matrix consisting of the predictor variables, the random variables, in the columns. So if you have, say, p equals 10, and your Monte Carlo simulation has 10 million passes, then this is a 10 by 10 million matrix. Yeah. So 10 million rows and 10 columns. And the vector v is the vector representing the value of which you like to calculate the conditional expectation. So let's check this. This here has 10 million passes. So this is a vector of length 10 million. Then X transposed is a matrix which has a row consisting of 10 million columns. So row times column, yeah, gives me a vector of length P. Yeah. So this here is a P vector. Actually, this is like the covariance of predictor variable y and the vector v. Yeah, it is the y multiplied with the v pass by pass, yeah, and then take the sum. Okay, if you have a 1 divided by n, it would be the covariance. Okay, so what's this here? This here is matrix multiplication row times column, but then I take the transpose. Yeah, so it's actually column multiplied with column, each column multiplied with a column for this matrix. So this is a P by P matrix. P times P matrix. From this matrix, I take the inverse. Okay, so P by P matrix, P is just a small number, the number of discretization of predictor variables. Yeah, so I can take the inverse of this matrix. And then P by P matrix times P vector is a P vector. Okay, so you see this here is just a P vector, your alpha star. And this matrix X transposed X, yeah, is actually more or less the covariance matrix of the predictor variables Y. Can we give a short proof here? Yeah. So I have the L2 distance of V minus F Y alpha. Yeah. So L2, which I would like to minimize. Instead of minimizing this, I can also minimize the square. Yeah. So this means I have the scalar product V minus, and now my F is just this special function. Yeah. So this is just, let me see, X times alpha. Yeah, so this here is just my f. F of y and alpha. So, but now I can write this also as v transpose v minus 2 alpha transpose x transpose v plus alpha transpose times x alpha. Okay. So now differentiate this function and set it to 0. So this means minus 2 times x transpose v plus 2 times x transpose x alpha should be 0, which is exactly this formula. Okay, so minimizing this L2 distance is analytically solvable, given that we can calculate here this inverse of this x transpose x. But actually, even if this inverse does not exist, you can define a generalized inverse with a singular value decomposition and so on to find the solution. Okay, so the functions y are called the basis functions. Yeah, and so now in the script, I also have some example how this would look like for a Black-Scholes model. But instead of looking into this example, So I move very quickly here. So this is your backward algorithm. This is the definition of the random variable of the predictor variables and the definition of now the optimal alpha. Yeah. So then you use this here to estimate your conditional expectation. So your conditional expectation is x transpose v multiplied with x transpose x inverse. This gives you the alpha, but the conditional expectation is x times alpha. So multiplying another x here gives you the conditional expectation. And then you use this here in your decision, and that's your evaluation of the Bermudan option. Okay, so the script concludes with some more remarks and some more pictures. You can look at this. And this is just the remark which I did, that the binning is just a special case of the least square regression, where now these predictor variables y are the indicator functions of the bin. Yeah? So you can actually check this in the implementation. If you use the indicator function as a variable y, then you will get a piecewise constant least square approximation of the conditional expectation, which is just the binning. For example, this picture then. And that's it for the regression method. So the script ends here with some references. So sorry for going through this a little bit quickly in the end, yeah, but I just wanted to show that we have actually done everything, yeah, from our 530 pages script now. And I would like to conclude with maybe another 1 or 2 minutes and show you the actual code of the evaluation of the Bermudan. So you can look at this also in more detail at home, because the code is of course, public in this repository here of FinMatLib. So you find at some place here. So we were looking at Monte Carlo methods for equity derivatives, so for a single asset model. And you find here some financial products like Asian option, digital option, European option, and there's also a Bermudan option. And this here is the Bermudan option valuation code. Actually, it's more general because it can also have different methods to perform the estimation of the exercise criteria. We did only one method in this session here, the conditional expectation estimate. So this one has also an upper bound method. So my Bermudan option has different exercise dates, different notionals, different strikes. So you specify this vector, and then actually the code is quite short. Yeah, it's not so long. So what we do is we go backward in time. So this is the backward algorithm. Then for each time step, I would like to have the numerator and the asset S, yeah, the asset S and the numerator here. And now I'm going that I first calculate what do I get if I exercise, yeah? The value of the payments if I exercise. So this is just my S minus K multiplied with the notional, and I do everything numerator relative. I divide by the numerator. So this is what I get if I exercise. Now I have to calculate the conditional expectation. So here's the conditional expectation. So this small stuff here builds the functions y, the regression basis functions, and then there is just an implementation of this regression, which is called conditional expectation estimator, and you can calculate a conditional expectation of these values. So this here is value if not exercise estimated. Yeah? And what is now our exercise criteria? Our exercise criteria is this number larger than what we get if we exercise? What we get if we exercise is the value which I have calculated here above. So this is our exercise criteria. And then we move down here and we just choose based on this exercise criteria, we choose the value if we get, if we continue. So if the expectation is estimated larger, or the value if we exercise. And then the code is done. Yeah. So this here is the loop over all times, then the code is done. So very short code. So the only thing which you maybe have to look at is here this conditional expectation by regression. And if you look here into this implementation, then you actually see that this is just what you have just seen on the slide. We calculate X transpose X times alpha equals X transpose times Y. Yeah. So the regression parameter alpha, here is called little x, is the solution of this linear equation. Yeah. So, and you see there is some linear algebra here involved. Yeah. Get linear regression parameters. So this here will just perform a solution of a linear algebra, linear equation. Yeah? So this is just some linear solver, whatever you like, singular value decomposition, or whatever you find to solve linear equations. Okay, so let me just finish by just running at least once evaluation with the Bermudan option. So here I have a small, so where is it? Small Monte Carlo evaluation test program. And in this test program, you can actually choose the evaluation of a European option, Asian option, and a Bermudan option. So let's run it. And this program will use this code, you know, the code I've just shown you, yeah, for the Bermudan option value. And you see that he calculates several options, a European option, which is here. So this is maybe just the option to exercise in T2. Then the Bermudan option, which is here. And some Asian option, which is here. The European option has a smaller value than the Bermudan option. So 20%, 21%, because European option can exercise only one time. This one can maximize the Bermudan because it can exercise two times. The Asian option has a smaller value than the European because it takes the average, and average is reducing variance. Yeah, reducing some sigma. And for the Bermudan option, actually, you see here two values. These are the two different methods. So we did estimation of the conditional expectation, and there's another method, an upper bound method. So actually, conditional expectation estimation gives you a lower bound for the value. This method here gives you an upper bound for the value. To conclude, why is conditional expectation giving us a conditional expectation estimation giving us a lower bound for the value? So why do we get a lower bound for the value of the Bermudan if we perform the estimation of the conditional expectation? And this is just this little error in the picture I have drawn. We used our conditional expectation estimator here for the decision, and the decision is not optimal. So if we have a suboptimal decision, so why is the decision not optimal? Because we have here an approximation which is not the accurate value. So if we have a suboptimal decision, we lose a little bit of values. Yeah? So this little error you saw in the picture, this little triangle, so here is below the Queen curve. It's always giving us a little bit less. Okay, so therefore, sometimes this method is also called lower bound method for the Bermudan option value, because performing this estimation gives us here a small error, and this error is always below the optimal one, below the optimal exercise strategy. So that was it for Bermudan option, and also we completed the full chapter, yeah, so that's nice. And that was it for today. Thank you.